the question is, like, this is kind of a statement I'll make, is that the resurrection only makes sense if the supernatural soul exists. And personally, I don't believe there's a supernatural soul. I think all we have is the mind that emerges from the brain. And I think there's some problems for people who posit the idea that there is a supernatural soul. And I'll list three of those and get your response. One of them is what you already brought up, where let's talk about a split brain patient. They have, actually on YouTube, there's a funny story of a doctor who talks about, there's this cord, basically, a communication channel between the left and right hemisphere, and they sometimes snip that in epileptic patients so they don't have a seizure. It stops it from spreading from one part of the brain to the other part of the brain. And when they do this, they have a person with a split left-right brain. They no longer communicate, and they could actually ask each part of the brain if they believe in God, and one person, part of the brain said yes, and the other part said no. So the funny question was, is this person going to heaven or hell because part of his brain believes and the other doesn't? So if you think there's a supernatural soul involved in that, that's a complication there.
Do you believe that your brain, the brain of Bernie, is a result of random collection of chemicals over billions of years?
Not so much. There are some random aspects, but it's not 100% random. Like, for example, animals do migration and mating dances and stuff, so there is some stuff they do that are non-random, but...
But certainly you would say, I would assume, being an atheist, that you would say your brain was not designed necessarily by a designer. It's just it has accumulated these traits over X number of billion years.
Right. Designed by a mindless nature, yes.
Well, then how can you trust your own thoughts and any conclusions you come to?
Well, that's why we invented the scientific method.
How do you know the scientific method is right? How can you know anything?
It's very easy because of the results of it. That's why they invented things on the scientific method, such as independent observation, because one person might be deluded, so you have to independently verify it. That's why we have placebo testing to make sure it's not a placebo, it's a real effect. That's why we had double-blind testing, because we know the doctor giving the test can subjectively influence it. So basically, we're trying to remove all these subjective errors out.
Yeah, I'm familiar with the different testing techniques and all that.
That's why we like logic and science, is because it's been proven. The proof is in the pudding, basically.
Well, what proof is there then that any animal can change to a different kind of animal? And I use the word kind, not species. We see variations in the dog family from Great Dane to Chihuahua, but everybody will tell you the variations are limited. You'll never get a dog as big as Texas. There's a limit someplace. Now, whether the Great Dane is the biggest or not, I don't know, probably close. And you won't get a Chihuahua might be the limit, or the toy Chihuahua, whatever, but you're not going to get one as small as a flea or a molecule. There's a limit to the variations. And the variations are still recognizable as the same kind of animal. So there's no observation. It's not logical to say it goes anything beyond that.
Well, I believe that there is so much evidence for evolution in the DNA. It's overwhelming. I feel like I see the evidence for it.
Well, give me an example. Evidence in the DNA, that's like saying I see evidence for evolution in the Microsoft code because... these six lines of code from PowerPoint match these six lines from Word.
Well, there is a sort of evolution in Microsoft code. It's called mimetic evolution, which is the evolution of ideas. For example, cars weren't just created from scratch. They did have precursors in railroad cars and even horse and buggy and things like that, the wheel and all that.
Right, but that came because of an intelligent person thinking of some way to fix it or improve it. You're wanting the same improvement without any intelligent being, i.e. without God.
Well, I believe in the DNA. You can see the bits change. There's a Christian who's a biologist at Trinity. I think it's called Trinity University. He's a practicing biologist, and he gave a lecture on there and over the evidence for evolution. And he's an evangelical Christian that fully accepts evolution, and he's trying to teach other Christians all this evidence. And I find it overwhelming myself. So.
Well, it accepts evolution. Again, what do you mean by evolution? Microevolution?
No, I'm talking about macro. That basically he's comparing the gene sequences across many different animals, like humans, dogs, fish.
Well, I don't think you realize that you've just proven my point. If he accepts evolution, then it's something he believes, and he accepts it as a belief system. It's a religion. Why doesn't he demonstrate it? Show me how fish and dogs are related. I'd like to see him I'd like to see those cross mate and make something.
Well, they can't mate because they're different species. So, but you know, according to evolution, they're not expected to mate.
The Bible says they bring forth after their kind. You know, any exceptions to that ever in the history of humanity?
Well, what about, I mean, a funny question there then, what about like the platypus? I mean, what kind of a kind is that? That thing, you know, because, you know, that's supposed to be the funniest creature ever because it's like a mammal that lays eggs, which is not really what a mammal does, and it's got a beak, and, you know, it's such a hodgepodge. It's a really funny creature. Is that supposed to be a kind?
Yeah, I think the platypus is a kind all of its own, and when platypus mate, they produce platypus without exception. And the fact that it has unusual traits and we can't put it into our classification system neatly, in our little, you know, cubbyhole system of, you know, mammals and fish, et cetera, that doesn't prove anything on creation or evolution. It just proves our classification system is limited. Like there's two-wheel vehicles and four-wheel vehicles and three-wheel vehicles. What if somebody makes a five-wheel or a 20-wheel? Where are we going to categorize it? Who says we have to categorize it? The platypus does seem to be a very unique individual animal. Okay. But they crossbreed, and they do produce more platypus, and there are no exceptions to that. None. So someone can believe that's evidence for evolution if they want, but I think it's a pretty cool animal, and apparently they like each other. I don't know.
Well,
they get along.
Well, going back to this problem about the soul, I was saying the resurrection only makes sense if there is a supernatural soul, and we probably agree that if there was no supernatural soul, the gospel story doesn't make sense. It's just that you believe in a supernatural soul, right?
Right. I think there's more to man than just a body and just electrical impulses in the brain.
Okay, so let me bring up two interesting cases. Sometimes people say, as Christians say, that like at the time of conception that a soul comes into the sperm and the egg after it joins together. Two interesting cases. One is identical twins. What happens there is the sperm and the egg, you know, they meet and they make an organism, the human starting, and it splits, you know, from 1 to 2 to 4 to 8 to 16 cells. And at some point, the whole mass splits off into two. So where there was one individual, now there's two individuals. And so the question is, if there is a soul on that one individual, what does God do? Does he give the second one a soul now, or was there two to begin with, two souls in one person, and they each took one? And then the other one is, the other case is there's a chimera where it's the opposite case where a woman could have two fertilized eggs growing. And then, so there's two basically humans in her womb, and at some point they merge together. It's called a chimera. And so the question there is, well, when they merge, does that thing now have two souls, or did one just die, or which one would die? How does that work? Those are questions.
Yeah, it was your premise that the soul comes in at conception. I don't know. I think life starts at conception. Now, whether that's the soul or not, I don't know. What is exactly the difference between the soul and the spirit? The Bible talks about in Hebrews 4:12, I believe, about the separating of the body, soul, and spirit. I think man is certainly more than just a body. We could classify plants as living, but only having a body. Animals as living, but also having a consciousness of life that plants don't seem to have. There's something different about animals from plants. And then man would have a body, a consciousness of life, and a consciousness of a higher creator, a God. Nearly all religions of the world, all people groups of the world have some form of religion, a consciousness that there is a higher power. And so that's the point, that there's more to man than just the body or the mind. We're not just animated meat. If we are, by your definition of what humans are, how do you tell right from wrong on any topic?
Well,
I
mean, I have a totally different understanding of what morality is than you do. I mean, I guess you must think morality is just what God says is right and wrong. You don't figure it out for yourself, right?
Well, if every man figures it out for himself, then Saddam Hussein was going around killing people. He's perfectly fine.
Well, in a way, everybody does figure it out for themselves. Your choice was just to lean on God or the Bible. Somebody else might lean on the Quran. Somebody else might lean on the Book of Mormon and somebody else Hindu scriptures. So in a way, you are making your own choice just to use the Bible.
Sure, which one is right? Was Hitler right to do what he did?
Well, okay, we're far afield now, but I could give a quick answer. Basically, the way I see it is, morality is all about behavior, and it comes down to what's good and bad, and good is about flourishing society, and bad is what hurts society. I believe there is a Nazi morality. There is a Christian morality. I have a natural philosophical morality. I believe my morality is superior to your Christian morality and the Nazi morality. And if you want to ask why, we would have to talk about principles. What principles do I use? And I use like consequentialism, reciprocity, individual free rights. And why do I choose those? Because they lead to a better society. So, I mean, to me, it's all pretty logical. It's not like God said it, so I believe it kind of thing.
Well, Hitler certainly wanted a better society. Mm-hmm. Eliminate the inferiors, the unfit, the
right.
mentally deficient, the mentally physically crippled. I mean, blonde-haired, blue-eyed, they're the supreme. Hey, I'm blonde-haired, blue-eyed. I don't know. Are you Bernie? Are you blonde-haired, blue-eyed?
No, not blonde-haired.
You should go ahead and kill yourself then. People let people like me take over the world.
Well, I would. Oh, so you're a blondie. Okay.
Oh, yeah. Blonde, blue-eyed. Natural, too. See?
Okay. Well, I can't argue against that. Yeah, I mean.
Okay.
So you don't know when the spirit comes into a person then? I mean, could it be at 10 weeks, 20 weeks when they're born, or you have no idea or don't care or what?
I don't know when that happens. And I think, but your premise was that because a woman can have a chimera, you know, two eggs that merge, or identical twins where, you know, same cell mass splits. Your premise was that if the spirit soul began at conception, then therefore we have a problem.
Mm-hmm.
And I said, I don't know that we have a problem. I don't know the answer to that. But I think you are creating the problem by your premise.
Well, there's a lot of Christians going around. That's why they're so opposed to abortion, because it's like, oh my gosh, as soon as the sperm and the egg meet, there's some kind of magical moment there, and there's a soul there, and now you're killing a soul.
Well, I know. I said I think you're killing a life. Life begins at conception.
Mm-hmm.
As far as the soul, I don't know. Good question.
Okay. Next question. Ready to move on?
Sure.
Okay.